What's up, guys? Thomas Mott here. Welcome into the Thomas Mott Show here on a Thursday. A lot is going on. I want to take a deep dive into the espionage that takes place between NFL teams, the spy games, the war games that take place between NFL teams who are going into a very big game. Now, you don't know what I'm talking about. I'll explain here in a second. But first thing you should do is go down below and subscribe to the channel. Plenty of more people have showed up here to support the Thomas Mott Show by hitting that red subscribe button. I appreciate you. Welcome. We got plenty of great stuff coming up here where we talk NFL, talk Philadelphia Eagles, and focus in on your guys' favorite team, obviously Philadelphia, here on the Thomas Mott Show. National story. Stay tuned for the end of today's show. We're going to get into NFL.com's recent quarterback ranking. Always tie it into Philadelphia. We'll see where they put Jalen Hurts. But the national story is going to be fun today, so stay tuned for that. Also, I want to make sure you guys are ready. Tomorrow, we're going to get into a preview. Well, not really a preview, a deep dive into the Viking game. The Vikings are scary. The Vikings are a very good football team. It feels like one of the most important games of the NFL season for Philadelphia. We'll come on Monday night. We'll discuss that tomorrow, so be sure to go ahead and stay tuned for that one. All right, I want to jump into today's video because you see the title of today's show, and it talks about espionage, right? It talks about the war games, the spy games going on between the Eagles and the Vikings. I want to explain what I'm talking about. Whenever two really good NFL teams are about to play, they try and get every single advantage possible in order to possibly win that football game, whether that means, you know, watching extra film, whether that means, you know, going over different game plans, or, as you'll see today, Philadelphia and the Vikings are doing this, getting their players to sign with your team. That way you can learn their playbook. Let's take a look. This is very interesting, and you got to kind of dig through it to actually see what's going on here. Here we go. So Bleeding Green Nation has the write-up, and this, of course, comes a couple of days ago, but as you'll see, it gets really juicy. Eagles place Derek Barnett on injured reserve, signed Vikings practice squad defensive end. So you go, oh, okay, well, you know, Derek Barnett on an injured reserve. Janarius Robinson signed for the Minnesota practice squad. He'll be on the Eagles active roster this weekend. Who cares, right? Not a big story. However, look what they had to say, not about Robinson, but about, at the very bottom of this article, what the Eagles could be doing here. Because you can break down, is Robinson, you know, a good rotational defensive lineman? Could he actually be an impactful player filling in for Derek Barnett? Blah, 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 blah. That's boring, right? What's really important about Janarius Robinson is not how good of a player he is, it's what team he's coming from, aka the Minnesota Vikings. You putting this together right now? Okay, here we go. Listen to this. Presumably, the Eagles are not signing Robinson to be an instant contributor. Barnett's injury opens up a spot for Tron Jackson to move up the depth chart. The Eagles only keep three defensive ends active in week one. Barnett, Josh Sweat, and Brandon Graham. Jackson figures to take Barnett's role, with Robinson being kept inactive for now. Now listen to this. The Eagles playing the Vikings less than a week after making this signing as a nice side bonus to adding Robinson. One would imagine the coaching staff will look to pick his brain on Minnesota's mechanisms, machinations, whatever you want to say it. That being said, it's not like the Eagles signed Robinson mainly for espionage purposes. Signing Robinson away from the Vikings practice squad requires the Eagles to both, one, guarantee him 3 weeks of salary, and two, have his roster spot counting down, count against 33 players limit for 3 weeks. Speaking of roster spots, the Eagles still have one opening after never making a corresponding move. In the aftermath of placing Andre Dillard on injured reserve last week, the team could look to promote punter returner Britton Covey to the roster if they don't sign, if they don't want to risk losing him. Or they could promote LaRaven Clark on the roster if they want to add more offensive tackle depth while Dillard is out. So what they are essentially saying here in Bleeding Green Nation is they're not the only reason for signing Robinson is to go ahead and replace Derek Barnett. They're going to pick his brain to learn as much as they can about the Minnesota Vikings. You saw the Lions do this last week. They signed one of our practice squad players in order to hopefully go ahead and pick his brain before the Eagle game. When you're going into a matchup with a football team that is either greater than you overall roster-wise or equal to you, as we'll talk about with the Vikings, I think they're very similar to Philadelphia, you have got to find a competitive advantage. And here's the big kicker. Philadelphia has already lost one of their key players to the Minnesota Vikings in Jalen Reagor, and you know Jalen Reagor is going to do everything he can to make sure the Eagles lose on Monday night and the Vikings win. I think Jalen Reagor is 100% spilling the beans on our playbook. That's why they went out and got Robinson, to go ahead and maybe counteract that and learn as much as they possibly can about the Vikings defense. You got to remember, right? Overall, this trade that sent Reagor to Minnesota was a couple of weeks ago. It happened on on August 31st, as the Schefter tweet here indicates. But you got to realize, Reagor's been in the Eagles system since he was drafted in 2020. That's two off seasons. That's almost 3 years of knowledge. They were telling him everything that he was supposed to know going into this season. Not like they knew for sure they were going to go ahead and trade him. It took the trade you see on your screen to pry him away from Philadelphia and over to Minnesota. Now, am I saying that the Eagles are going to lose because Jalen Reagor has all this extra knowledge about the Eagles offense. No, right? In the end, this sort of thing happens all the time, but it's worth noting that this is a very big game, and Philadelphia's signing of Robinson, I think, is trying to counteract what Reagor possibly could or may not know about their offense in order to make sure... excuse me, that they have a really, really good chance of being on equal ground going into this game. This is a massive matchup, and we're going to talk about it in our video coming up tomorrow, and obviously, you know, more into what's actually going on in terms of the you know, offense, defense, special teams, where Philadelphia needs to be good or bad. But this is extremely interesting to me. I think it's fun to kind of look a little bit further behind the curtain because most people, you know, blog readers and or blog writers and national pundits will never talk about the inside game that goes on behind the game trying to get a competitive advantage over your opponent. I think Philadelphia is 100% and the Vikings are 100% trying to get as big of a competitive advantage over each other going into Monday night because they know these are two of the better teams in the NFC. These might be the two best teams in the NFC, and the win right now goes a long way not only for playoff seeding, but also home field advantage. If both teams were to have a similar record by the end of the year, the head-to-head tiebreaker means something. This game on Monday is absolutely massive. Okay, I want to move over here to another Bleeding Green Nation article that picks up on what The Ringer talks about in terms of the Eagles' defense. By the way, am I crazy talking about the espionage inside the NFL? Whether that's, you know, spying on other teams or trying to get other teams' playbooks. Do you think I'm crazy? Let me know down below. I don't think I am. I mean, I think this actually happens, and obviously Bleeding Green Nation talked about it happening. Will it be a big difference? You know, who knows? But it's fun to kind of break it down and talk about it going into this big game. Either way, we'll see your guys' comments. I read every single one, so if you guys want to chat, we can do it down there. So The Ringer hates the Eagles' defense, apparently, which we'll throw up here on your screen right now. This is a writer at The Ringer talking about, you know, picking against the spread or picking games in week two. Quote, last week's performance was pretty much ideal for Eagle fans. The team won, but they still had plenty to complain about. Thanks, Ringer. Okay, yeah, I guess we do complain a lot, whatever. The offense went up and down the field, piling up 27 first downs and 455 yards against the Lions, but the defense was a disaster, allowing the Lions to score two touchdowns on four of their final five possessions, The Vikings looked like one of the NFL's best coached teams in Kevin O'Connell's debut. They schemed up explosive plays for wide receiver Justin Jefferson, and their defensive performance was encouraging. If last week was any indication, the Vikings defense will play a lot of zone and mix up their fronts to make life hard for opposing quarterbacks. This is a toss-up game, but the bottom line is I have very little faith in the Eagles' defense after what we saw last week. Okay, this is what happens whenever you're a national writer, right? And this is, I don't know who this is for The Ringer. I don't know if it'll even tell me who it is coming from The Ringer. Kapedia, how you say his name? I'm not sure. If I butchered the name, I'm sorry. But this is not an Eagle beat writer, right? This is not somebody from Bleeding Green Nation, not somebody from 94.1 WIP, not someone from The Enquirer. This is somebody who covers the entire National Football League. They look at every single game from a 30,000-foot perspective, and they can only take away so much because they don't know the teams, right? And that's not anything against any sort of national, you know, pundit, right? You see Stephen A. Smith all the time. Stephen A. sometimes will talk about a team who he clearly doesn't know everything there is to know about, and he'll mention a player who was traded away. He did that with Philadelphia, mentioning Jalen Reagor, who was traded to the Vikings, right, a couple of weeks ago, as we just talked about. So you can't blame people like this, but to talk about Philadelphia's defense being absolutely horrible and getting into this whole idea that they are going to get run over by the Vikings and the Vikings are going to out-scheme Philadelphia, to me, is ridiculous. It was week one, guys. It was week one. And the Eagles' defense, up until those final five possessions, was lights out. That game should have been 38-14. Right, 38-10, whatever the number was before the Vikings or before the Lions started to go on a little bit of a run there. I think Philadelphia is going to clean it up. I think what happened with the Lions game, looking back on it now, is about as good as you could possibly hope for a defense that probably was feeling themselves going into that game. I mean, I bet the Eagles defense, with all the new additions, Reddick and Bradbury and, you know, Kazir White and Jordan Davis, they were like, we're going to crush the Lions. Like, we're going to absolutely kill the Lions. Don't even have to try. It's not going to be difficult. And then they were crushing the Lions. They were feeling themselves, a little pat in the back. And then it was like, wait a second, hang on. Detroit is a good football team. They've schemed themselves well against us. We got to wake up. And in the end, they were able to, and the offense bailed them out with that 4th-and-1 sneak by Jalen Hurts. But I think this was a good thing for Philadelphia because now there was not going to be any sort of, overbearing or bloviating going into the Viking game because the Vikings are very, very good. But now you get that extra bit of like, hey, We got embarrassed in the fourth quarter last week. We got to step it up or we're going to get embarrassed in all four quarters against the Minnesota Vikings. And so I think that overall, a national media person would obviously not want to pick Philadelphia or would really want to be disparaging of Philadelphia's defense. But you and I both know that just because you have one game in week one doesn't mean the entire game was terrible. It was a couple of bad drives, a couple of good plays by Jared Goff and DeAndre Swift and that Lions offense. I think Philadelphia figured things out defensively and they're going to be much, much, much better on Monday night against the Vikings. Doesn't mean they're going to win. Doesn't mean Justin Jefferson won't have, you know, two touchdowns and 10 receptions, but I don't see 35 points coming from the Eagles defense. It'll be a much more low scoring game and a lot closer of a game the entirety of the Monday Nighter, just due to the fact that the Eagles defense is going to wake up and the Vikings are a very, very good football team and the odds of Philadelphia blowing them out are very, very slim. Again, we'll talk more about that game coming up in a future video, so stay tuned for that because I think there's a lot more to break down than just Justin Jefferson versus the Eagle defense, right? I'll just leave it at that. Okay, National League story of the day. We always like to go ahead and mix in a little bit of NFL. I love quarterback power rankings. You guys know I love power rankings. And now we have a quarterback index, week two, from Mark Seltzer. Seltzer? So you say his last name? It's like a seltzer drink over there. Whatever. He talks about, obviously, ranking all 32 quarterbacks, and it's fun to see where he has everybody, but most notably Jalen Hurts. Here's what we have. Allen is one. Duh. Patrick Mahomes is two. Duh. Then he has Justin Herbert, three. Tom Brady, four. Rodgers has fallen three spots to five, although I agree, you can't take Rodgers out of the top five just yet, just because he had a couple of, you know, drops from his receivers. Christian Watson does not mean you bump him down. Then you have Lamar Jackson, six. He was good. Joe Burrow, seven. I agree, I would not abandon Joe Burrow right now. I think he's going to be just fine. Stafford, eight, is interesting. Stafford's going to have a big bounce back next couple of weeks, or that Rams drama is going to get very, very interesting. Kirky at nine, Russell Wilson at 10, Kyler at 11. How about that? Jalen Hurts at 12. I'm not too mad about Hurts being at number 12. I think that Hurts can be a lot better than Kyler in terms of ranking-wise by the end of this year. I think it's going to take a little bit because most National League guys view Kyler better than Jalen Hurts. He's a better passer, according to them. You know, better passer, whatever. A little bit faster of a runner, whatever. But I think Kyler and the Cardinals are in for a really rough season, and so I think he's going to drop. But I'm fine with putting Russ ahead of Jalen Hurts. I'm fine with putting Kirk ahead of Jalen Hurts. As of right now, Kirk Cousins looks very, very good. He was lights out with a really good completion percentage in that win against the Packers. So fine, he's fine with being a little bit higher. But Hurts being at 12 to me is a really, really good spot and shows you he's a couple more wins away from being considered a top 10 quarterback in the National Football League, which a lot of your non-Eagle friends would say was ridiculous 5 months ago and now not so ridiculous. Tannehill 13, Carr 14, Jameis Winston 15, Matt Ryan. Yeah, these are all guys that I would take Hurts over the vast majority of these players. I mean, you would take Hurts, maybe not Carr, but long term you'd take a Hurts over Carr. Obviously, Winston, Matt Ryan's too old. Two was too much of a question mark. Wins through two picks, almost lost that game. You get my point. So fun to see Jalen Hurts sitting there at number 12. He can definitely continue to improve and go up. And if he beats the Vikings on Monday night and looks good doing it, you're going to start to see the great change, right? The great green wave just kind of washing through the national media pundits and all the guys who are saying, yeah, the Eagles are really good, minus Jalen Hurts because Hurts isn't very good. That is going to start to go ahead and change. It'll be like, wait, the Eagles are really good. Oh, and Jalen Hurts has greatly improved. I guarantee you that would be the storyline if the Eagles win come Tuesday morning. All right, there you go. This has been the Thursday edition of the Thomas Mott Show. We will have one coming up here tomorrow as well, so stay tuned for that. If you guys like it, hey, listen, I mean, a lot of new people have joined the show, and if you guys like watching the show, thumbs up, subscribe. You guys know the drill, and obviously we will talk to you guys in tomorrow's video. See ya.